know this pain. Why do you lock yourself up in these chains? No one can change your life except for you. Don't ever let anyone.
Yeah, it's your boy Crypto Blood, and welcome to another episode of My Two Satoshis. It is December 15th, 2018. Give a shout out to my man, D-Vault Official, for that Wilson Phillips, Hold On. Sounds like I've heard this song before. I don't know. I can't remember where I know this song. Maybe it was a soundtrack for a 90s movie or something. But again, thank you for the song request. Good to switch it up a little bit sometimes. Hope you guys are doing well today. It's Saturday. Got some errands to run myself, so I wanted to make this one. It's actually probably not going to be short, but it is only one topic, one article we're going to look at. And I got to give shout outs to Bit Curious Mom from the Web Buy Room for dropping this, actually. Very detailed write up in Reddit about Omisego. And this individual kind of just puts it all on the table, shows where they've promised things, missed those dates, those target dates. And he does an in-depth analysis on Omisego. You know, I'm all about just telling the truth, being truthful to yourself first and foremost. And I think this guy has some very good analysis on Omisego, a very good critique of Omisego. This is one of those coins that was big in 2017. Huge, man. It was a lot of buzz about Omisego. I got a lot of my people into Omisego. I was in Omisego. Can't remember where I sold. It was way higher than this. But I just started to see, like, and I wasn't even following it closely, but I started to see, like, no progress. It was just like, what is going on? You got a lot of money raised. You got a lot of people behind you. Why aren't you guys making any progress? So I kind of just dumped it, reallocated my portfolio at that time into something else, which I probably ended up losing money anyway, so it didn't really matter. But just looking at it from a long-term perspective, is this something you should be holding on to? You know, after this article, it should definitely give you more clarity, so we'll take a look at that. But first, I want you guys to jump over to cryptoblood.io. You can still join that BitMEX automated trading bot. The bot is up over 240% year to date. Long and short, you don't need a lot of money because it is leveraged trading. Little can go a long way. You know, for example, you can start with like $250 and each trade will be, you'll be trading roughly $2,000 per trade. So you can kind of just scale up from there depending on what your risk tolerance is for the algorithm. But it's plug and play. And all the performance for the algorithm is available on TradingView, so it's all transparent and you see what you get. Doesn't mean the performance will be the same going forward in the future, but at least you know what the track record is for the algo thus far. So cryptoblood.io, you'll see a link right there on the homepage to sign up, people. And forgot to say, if you are a WebBot member, there is a deep discount for you. I took it down from one, but it's pinned in like the original room. And I think the crypto room I took down. So you have to look in the main WebBot room for the pinned message. I'll put it back up there maybe in a couple weeks. I have another pinned message up there right now. For individuals that want to come on my show, you can do that. Check out the details in the crypto WebBot room. Just kind of like a year-end review. Talk about your frustrations about the crypto space. What your thoughts are for 2019. Just get it all on the table. Talk about this year and be just a nice therapeutic type of session with Crypto Blood. You don't have to do it with video. It can be audio only if you want, but you'll see the details. There's a link for you to sign up to my calendar to schedule yourself in there. So again, check it out, WebBot Room for that, and CryptoBlood.io for the algo. Now let's take a look at this market cap. Oh my God, we're right at 100.9 billion. Man, we're on the brink of breaking that $100 billion market cap. Did not think we would see ourselves back here. I'm not gonna lie. I've been bearish pretty much all year, but I have to admit, I did not see us getting this low. Bitcoin's dominance is at 55.3%, and this is a very neat visual of the market cap. I'm going to start showing it from this perspective so you can kind of get a visual. I'm a visual person. I learn and remember from visual and audible sources. So check this out here. We're below the trough of December 7th, which was 106 billion. So us breaking that will definitely mean that's a bearish move to the downside to make newer lows. And if we go out 6 months, guys, this is gonna look horrible. So again, this area when we were in the 200 billion range was when we held that $6,000 Bitcoin for a while, and then we broke there, the whole Bitcoin Cash fork drama and all that, and some other things as well. But the trend has been steady, as you can see. And I think this was also accelerated by hedge fund redemptions and tax harvesting going on right now. So people with the tax harvesting are probably going to wait all the way to the end of the year just to make sure they get as much of the losses kind of locked in for future deductions, and then probably buy right back in if they're true believers in the crypto space. But the algo, yep, we're still short here at this point, man. We're very close to the 3K. I think ultimately that's where we will test, and we'll see what kind of price action we get there. I have no clue, but my theory is that we will see a huge bounce off of 3K like we did in 2017. But hey, maybe not. It's a different year, different dynamics. I'm just purely going off price speculation. So I'll just keep an eye on this for you guys. The article, the one and only article for today, is out of Reddit. Very, very nice detailed write-up about Mizigo. Very good critique of the company by this gentleman here. Title of this post is "My Take on Mizigo: Expectations Versus Realities, Management Expectations, Developmental Status, and Short-Term, Mid-Term Future Analysis and Concerns." So he says, he starts off by saying, "Some might know me as I've been around since the beginning. Shortly after ICO, I was very excited to the point of shilling it to friends, family on Reddit and Twitter, defending this system, project, and community. I try educating people, correcting FUD, and actively engaging in discussions. I'm not posting this for sympathy, upvotes, or whatsoever. I want everyone to know what has been said, how it has been said, and when it's been said, and compare that with what we have right now. If I posted anything wrong, correct me and I'll stand corrected. I also believe there are things going on that need attention for the sake of the future of this project. English is not my native language, so I'm trying to keep this post as readable as possible. This token is supposed to be a utility token that will eventually earn you fees. This way, the token will have an intrinsic value in contrast to many tokens out there. It all felt like no-brainer by buying in, especially compared to other tokens, currencies out there." Well, I'm gonna stop right there. So with that being said, earning fees off of the token, that's essentially a dividend. Now that, you know, we know more about what the SEC is all about. So this is going to be a no-go for any U.S. citizens. I'm going to be honest with you. Whether I like it or not, this is not going to be a go for U.S. citizens. So let's see what this guy says here. "The last few months were absolutely brutal. Times like these also make you critically assess your investment and evaluate where we stand and where we are heading. Of course, bear markets can clog your mind and reasoning abilities, possibly even more than in the bull markets." I disagree. I think bull, you have more of a euphoria than in the fear mode in bear markets. But I don't know. It's teach his own how they look at that. "But I have been seriously emotionally attached to this investment. That's the first problem, because I want to see it succeed so bad. I care about the project and I appreciate the people working on it." He highlights here, "We can all come to the conclusion on Mizigo is far from succeeding in their goals laid out in their white paper, crowd sale docs, and public communications. And I believe now is the time to evaluate and look back all the way to the moment of Mizigo was announced on the 17th of February 2017, close to 22 months ago, and announcements, developments, plus communications by the team along the way." So he says, "I will start at the beginning and use tweets from the official Mizigo Twitter account." It says here, "Announcement of OMG. Notice how This tweet already contains Q4 2017, which immediately provides a sense of this is all around the corner. All we need is a token sale done in Q2 of 17. Yeah, he's just kind of commenting about the tweets here. The first few public communications by the El Musico team were tweets about Tendermint. For example, this retweet by the Musico team, POS research so advanced already. Then there is this retweet of an article containing an interview with Thomas Greco, whose role has mysteriously diminished from the 20th of February 2017. Interesting little outtake from this article. Wendell Davis, product development lead for Musico, said, "If you are going to launch a mobile money platform, you need people to accept it. You need merchants, etc. The jurisdiction for Musico doing a project like this is we have already done that type of business development with 3,000 plus major merchants, from the likes of airlines to large corporate holding companies that have restaurants and things like that. That business is already done. Those relationships already exist." Goes on to say here, regarding the token sale and the initial role of the token holders, he added, "We want to be a variety of stakeholders, and we want those stakeholders to have access initially to what we're calling our free revenue. Basically, while we are operating this network of wallets, whether on behalf of this company or that company, we are taking small fees. To begin, OMG token holders will be able to claim a percentage of fee revenue so that they can participate in this." Notice how it suggests the token is going to have utility initially. And I'm not going to, you know, go through each one because it's a fairly lengthy analysis here, but I just want to highlight a couple of these. In May of 2017, on the 3rd, he said there is a tweet with Vitalik and Poon sitting at a table with Omizigo. Shortly after that, there's an Ethereum meetup with Poon and Thomas Greco. And just a week later, we have an actual OMG white paper written by Joseph Poon. The first question that comes to mind, he says, is where's Joseph Poon since writing the white paper? I cannot recall him ever being publicly tied to Omizigo, and I've only seen him appear in the Plasma Implementer calls, which are very, very hard to follow for non-techies like myself. Hardly a word on OMGs from Poon ever since. Weird. And he goes on to say, I'm just going through a few things mentioned in this document. He says, he highlights, our technical advisory board includes some of the leading minds in the blockchain space, like Vitalik Buterin, the creator of Ethereum, amongst others. So the guy on Reddit here continues on with kind of pointing out some things here. The Musico network is intrinsically agnostic between fiat and decentralized money. As far as adoption and use go, the system is constructed so that the best currencies will win. That is not true, he says. For now, only ERC-20s will be transacted on the Omizigo network initially. God knows how long it's going to take before we actually get to transact fiat, etc., and others on the OMG network. A big if, any. Goes on to say here, we have also entered into an agreement with several regional and national conglomerates to support implementation of digital wallet solutions for supply chain, finance, and loyalty programs. During the first phase of our work, we will refine and implement these existing business agreements and relationships, as well as focus on onboarding new partners and clients. His rebuttal to that is, this is a sensitive issue, of course. There are NDAs and details to be kept secret. However, who knows, these agreements are still in place. Mind you, this crowd sale doc is written 18 months ago, and there is not a working product in sight. While missing deadlines is fine, but things move fast. Competition is deadly. Large companies invest or opt in on different project startups all the time. An agreement or MOU is basically pointless if there is no product. So then he kind of highlights some of the roadmap stuff, like the white label wallet SDK supposed to launch. That never did. The hosted server node is constructed to be compatible with open blockchains. That never was delivered. And then it goes on to talk about their focus on developing and applying already developed centralized exchange and clearing solutions that are in line. So in June, he's got stuff from June here. ICO has started, and our favorite CEO has now posted a blog, kind of goes into that, in which he states the already tens of thousands of Musico merchants will be beneficial to Musico. Yeah, I remember hearing that. I remember hearing And what really was intriguing about Amizigo is that they already had a vertical for them to implement right into. So that's why I was kind of excited about Amizigo, because they already had the pipeline there built for scalability. So he says in August, he says the shilling starts. We have numerous tweets of Amizigo posting pics with Vitalik. And of course we have June and the Amizigo Twitter retweeting the infamous Palm Beach article over here. How about the retweeting an article about token price recovery after support from Thai Ministry? And he goes on to say, notice how the cash in out touch point will be revealed at the end of the year, which is 2017, they meant. Then this tweet above, he says, Amizigo receives $25 million in funding from MUFG. And he says, notice how this is for Amiz, not Amizigo. And then October, wow, we're not even out of 2017 here. In October, the release of the roadmap states that staking possible in Q2 of 2018, cash in, cash out details, end of 17. Neither of these, he says, these milestones were ever hit or explained. And then another tweet in April talks about this crypto exchange, user-facing crypto exchange now. And he kind of quotes here from the article, for the purpose of incubating large transaction volume and diversity of tradable assets on OMG. To this end, Amizigo will launch a new subsidiary which will aggressively develop a user-facing crypto exchange network this year. Notice how this quote can be interpreted in two ways. Either the subsidiary will be launched this year, after which development still needs to start, or this exchange is supposed to launch this year. 8 months after the announcement, it's all silent. And he goes on to say here, no exchange, no DEX, no acquired exchanges, nothing to report on. What I do know is that the Go exchange team is actually still looking to hire and nothing has been built yet. Amazing. So he just kind of goes on and on. I think you guys should really read this just to get an understanding of what it looks like when a company, basically, this is what, and I said this way back. I said, because, you know, I've had two tech startups, and I have gone through the whole VC run roadshow trying to raise funds, and I learned a lot just about the VC world and stuff. And one thing I've learned is that when a company is overcapitalized, meaning they raise too much money, normally that is the death of them. That is their downfall. When you have too much money, too many resources, you don't adequately use those resources that you have. You have these grandiose ideas and you take more risks than you need to. You give them exactly what they need, plus or minus maybe 6 months of runway to actually keep afloat. But when you have too much money, and this is what happened, I saw this happen so much in 2017 and going into 18. These companies got so much money, these ICOs raised so much money, and there's no incentive now. There's no incentive for them to show and prove, one, because they have all the money up front, and then secondly, their tokens, they're not equity. It's not equity in the company that they gave you. So it's like, we'll take our time, and, you know, laissez-faire type of attitude, in my opinion. And that's why I felt like, you know, I don't think Pillar is a scam, but I think them having raised that much money actually hurt them, because they felt there was a cushion. When you don't have a cushion, you know, you gotta get on it, and you really gotta make it happen. So, you know, that's one of the downfalls of this whole ICO season that we had in 2016 and into 17. They were just flush with too much cash. He summarizes by saying, I refuse to give in to the sunk cost fallacy many others have. There's a very, very good chance this token will never recover because of its lack of utility and the complexity of what they're trying to achieve. A lot of startups never accomplish anything in the end. OMG is a subsidiary of Amizigo. Amizigo is not dependent on OMG. Never forget that. That's true. And then, you know, another thing is, you know, we talk about these projects succeeding, and we're so sure it's going to be the next big. In traditional investments and in traditional markets, the failure rate is like 90%. So how are we so just sure that the projects we like are going to succeed when in traditional markets they only succeed 10% of the time? So that's, you know, that's something to just keep in mind and kind of focus your perspective or refocus your perspective. This is, crypto is highly speculative, and if it's 10% success rate with traditional startups, you better believe the success rate, or failure rate, maybe I should put it that way, is going to be north of 95-98%. So just keep that in mind. Just want you guys to understand that. Thought this was a good article, pretty lengthy. I didn't read the whole thing, try to get through some, you know, a lot of it, but you know, I venture for you guys, those who are on Mizigo token holders or was, definitely go check this out. I'll leave a link to this in the description of this video. But that's pretty much it for today. Give a shout out to D-Vault Official for that song request again. Make sure you guys like and subscribe. Share this video. I made it through the crypto purge. Actually, it was a YouTube purge where they got rid of a lot of spam subs on many channels. Crypto influencers were hit hard, I heard. I think I only lost like 48 subs. So shout outs to all my supporters out there. It's your boy Crypto Blood. That's my two Satoshis for December 15th, 2018. I'm out of here. Holla.